Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining us. My name is Kelechi Okere. I am the global director of Elsevier's Seamless Access Initiative. That word is always hard to say. And if you're wondering what that means and why Elsevier is hosting a webinar that involves OpenAthens, I can explain. Over the past 18 months, we've been working on a project to look at the feasibility of using federated access as a primary or only means of access to Elsevier resources, or just, you know, resources in general. Since we've been seeing a trend of some customers coming to us via federated access only, or having both IP and other access methods alongside federated access. But during the pandemic, the federated access usage also increasing at a pretty rapid clip. So we've just been investigating what that means and what, from a customer's or university's perspective, what does it mean when universities or libraries start to leverage federated access more? And what does it mean for us internally to accommodate and to serve those needs better? So with that, we've also been working closely with OpenAthens, right, and customers around the world. So today we'd like to highlight a fantastic case study from University of Johannesburg. And with that, I'd like to introduce my colleague, Janina Van der Westhuizen. She's the head of technical services at UJ, and she and her team worked on the transformation of moving the library's access from mainly IP-based access to mainly federated access using OpenAthens. So we're also joined by James Edwards, who is international sales manager, covering Africa and other regions. Before we other regions for OpenAthens. Before we get started, just a couple of housekeeping items. The webinar is being recorded, so as an attendee, you will get a link to the recording after we conclude the other webinar. Please use the questions box to post questions for the panel. As the presentation is happening. After Janina's presentation, we will then have a Q&A session. And if you have any questions about Elsevier's Seamless Access Initiative or things of that nature, you can contact your account manager or customer consultant. If you have any questions specifically about OpenAthens not related to this webinar or just in general, you can also direct those questions to James. So that's why we have him on hand. So now I turn it over to Janina to take us through the UJ case study. Thank you so much, Janina, for joining us and doing this for other colleagues.
You're most welcome. A warm welcome to everybody from a cold and windy Johannesburg. I gave the title to my presentation as Breaking the Mold, the Trials and Tribulations of the UJ Open Athens Team. And just to let you know who the UJ Open Athens Team is, it is Johanni Steyn and then Faith Zalekile, Hona Matlakala, Ntabi Munyahisa, and then myself, Janina Van der Westhuizen. And we are actually all from technical services at UJ. And that photo that you see is actually a photo of one of our campus libraries. So if you're anything like me, you would like to know what this presentation is about. So this is the table of contents. We're just going to have a background of UJ, just a little bit of perspective. I thought that we could not do this presentation without looking at the impact of COVID, a quick introduction to Open Athens, and then the reasons why UJ wanted to break the mold, the process that we followed, the outcome, and the way forward. So if you look at UJ, we're the University of Johannesburg, but we call ourselves UJ for short. We have a student population of over 50,000, so it's quite a lot, including 3,000 students from international countries, 80 international countries. We have four different campuses, and we have eight faculties spread over these campuses. We have five physical libraries, and the executive director of our libraries is Prof. Maria from ARP. The university made a decision a few years ago to, instead of appointing a librarian as head of the library, they appointed someone from the academy. So Prof. Maria used to be the vice dean of humanities at UJ. I don't know if you're aware of it, but UJ has a strong focus on the fourth industrial revolution. So we're really trying to see how we can use technology to work for us. This slide is not very clear, but it gives you some kind of indication of the faculties and the schools we have. It is quite diverse. We have business and economics, and then art, design, and architecture, education, humanities, health sciences, and then also engineering, law, and then science. Okay, so the impact of COVID on the university and the library. UJ literally moved overnight from a contact university to online teaching, and I'm sure it's the case for most of the contact universities that are listening today. It placed a massive burden on our academic staff, who had to change their method of teaching and the assessment in a very short space of time. And then universities had to make sure that the students have the resources to attend class in the online environment. And for us, it was very important that our students complete the academic year. Our academic year runs from January to December. Of course, this had a massive financial impact on higher education institution, not only UJ, but all higher education institutions. Most of the UJ staff started working from home since then. We had a short space of time where we could go back to the university, but we're in the middle of our third wave, so everybody, almost everybody's working from home again. The physical libraries were closed for most of 2020, and again for the past month or so it has been closed. That places a huge dependency on the online library information resources and also on online assistance. So the library decided that our focus will be fast and reliable access to information and information resources, and that is supported by trusted and innovative technology, which then links us to the fourth industrial revolution, which is also a focus area of the university. Right, so the next two slides, I'm going to give you a short introduction to Open Athens, and here I mainly used what was available in the literature. We all know that IP authentication used to dominate the authentication landscape, and when you make use of IP authentication to access information resources off-site, you have to make use of a proxy or another remote access system. The most used proxy IP authentication system, I think the one that everyone is familiar with, or most people are familiar with, is EasyProxy. But in the case of UJ, we used WAM. And really, IP authentication used to work very well for a long period of time. But then it started to hit a few barriers. And one of the first barriers that it hit was security practices. It was easier to exploit IP address authentication. And then the cost and the time in maintaining proxy servers. And that includes the frequent updating of proxy stanzas. And also the increased access issues and the difficulty to pinpoint and resolve those issues also became a serious problem. And it was quite interesting when I looked at these issues in the literature, it was exactly the same issues that we experienced at UJ. However, in the past 10 years, the access authentication evolved rapidly. And I think SAML played a huge part in that. SAML stands for Security Assertion Markup Language. And it significantly increases security as it locks individual users to identify exactly where the security breach took place, which addresses the security issues. I think the beauty of SAML is that it offers a very good balance between privacy, security, and personalization. And this resulted then in the federated authentication. And federated authentication is a way of linking a user's identity to multiple systems and then allowing the user to quickly move from one resource to the other one while maintaining security. There are two federated authentication systems available, both using SAML. The one is Shibboleth, which is open source, and then we have OpenAthens, which is a paid service. I put in this slide because I think it's a good demonstration of how SAML is used in federated authentication. It acts as a link between the users and the directory, and then also between the users and the service providers. If you want more information on this, I'm sure that the people from OpenAthens will be able to give you detailed information of how it works. Okay, so why did UJ wanted to break the mold? And I specifically use these words because we've been using IP authentication for such a long time. So to move to something differently really felt like we were breaking the mold. And we actually followed quite a few clues when we decided that we had to move and try something new. And the first clue was that the new resources and supplies that we wanted to add no longer supported IP authentication. When we wanted to add new platforms, for example, for our ebooks, some of the suppliers were very blunt and they told us they don't use or support IP authentication any longer. The second clue was the issues that we had with database access when we moved over to online teaching during COVID. And then the majority of our users then used our resources remotely. This was a major, major headache for us last year. And if I remember correctly, a year ago this time, we still battled, you know, with some of our resources either not being accessible or for some other reason they just didn't display right. So we spent enormous amounts of time to try to resolve these issues with several stakeholders and role players involved. And also from UJ's side, we had a complicated internal structure between technical services, the library IT, and the university IT. While technical services was responsible for the electronic resource management of our databases, the WAM access and the WAM table allied with library IT in the library, and they were dependent again on university IT. So it was quite a complicated issue. The fourth clue was when it came to the end of the year and we had to renew our electronic resources with a limited budget, we actually realized that we have limited data available regarding the usage of our electronic resources with regards to decision making and especially with regards to the information budget. And then the last clue, and that's something we all know, but we librarians don't want to talk about it, is that our clients do not necessarily access our resources from our library webpage or from the database list. We actually kind of know that Google is king when it comes to the students. So the process that we followed in moving over to federated access was we first started with investigation and research. So Johanni set the ball rolling and she said, you know, I really want to add these platforms to our ebooks, for our ebooks. And some of the suppliers said, well, we don't support IP authentication. So we started with the footwork, attending webinars, reading up. Johanni did a lot of the background information and she started sharing what she learned with the rest of the team. And when we heard what she had to say, you know, we just knew that this is the answer to many of our issues. So we presented the findings and got approval from our executive director. We decided to go with Open Athens and not with Shibboleth. We tried open source in the past and we kind of found it difficult and cumbersome. So we thought we'll rather go for Open Athens. And then we also decided that we will implement via EBSCO and with their assistance. The reason for that is apart from the fact that the academy was overloaded at that stage, so was the library staff, you know, and especially technical services for us trying to find new ways to do our work from home in a hybrid environment. So we really didn't have the time to figure this out on our own. So we thought we'll draw on the expertise of people who really have a lot of knowledge in this area. We also decided for a soft rollout, and we decided that we're going to start with the databases that we had the most issues with. And the reasoning behind that was, you know, many of these databases had so many issues throughout the year. If we do get them working through Open Athens, then yay. If we don't, you know, we actually had nothing to lose. So then we followed step three, and that was the setup and the technical implementation. And to be very honest with you, this was the easiest part of the whole process. We actually started with this last year. I think it was in October, November, and I don't think I only speak for myself, but for my colleagues as well. By that time, we were exhausted. You know, it's been a rough year, both from a work point of view, you know, and then from a personal point of view with all of us trying to adapt to the new circumstances. So we thought, okay, you know, we'll kind of start now, but we'll really, you know, put in effort when we come back in January the next year, because UJ closes in December. So we got the ball rolling in October, November, and it was like we came back in January and everything was done. We had one IT person that did some configuration on the UJ IT site, and we had to contact one or two suppliers just to help with the setup a little bit, and we completed everything in 2 months. In our case, we decided to use the university directory and not the library management directory for authentication. So basically, OpenAthens connect in real time with the university directory for staff and for students, which is great because that directory is updated in real time, while we have a little bit of a delay when it comes to our library management system. And then I just include, these steps that we followed together with EBSCO, the gathering of information, and then the questionnaire that we have to complete. And then we had to get the assistance of the IT person at UJ as well. EBSCO contacted most of the vendors. They just asked us to help with one or two South African ones. And then the user account and the directory was set up. Oh, sorry. Let me just get my slides again. Okay, so the fourth step was the internal rollout that we did. We did intensive testing at the technical services department before we introduced it to our colleagues. And then we introduced it to the rest of the library staff during staff meetings. Again, we had to do it in the online environment. With Zoom meetings and team meetings. We made use of presentations and demos, and we also created the LibGuide. And then the library staff started to test and to use the resources that we moved over. And the databases that we selected for phase one is now fully implemented. So what was the outcome? I'm happy to say to you that we were able to successfully add new and current suppliers who do not support IP authentication. And I think we were even happier when we noticed that the issues that we had with databases last year has been resolved. We are now spending less time, or almost no time, trying to resolve access problems. We have more data available on information resources and a better understanding of usage patterns, and that I will show to you just now. Even though we don't have retrospective information available, I think it's a good start for where we are now. Our clients can now access some of our resources from the web without using the library webpage, because some of the suppliers, and I think Elsevier is one, they actually have an OpenAthens link on their webpage. The technical services staff now have more control with regards to authentication, and we really had excellent support with regards to OpenAthens so far. It really helps if you work with experts who know the environment. Right, so this is our WAM authentication page. You can see that it's rather complicated. You have an option A and an option B, and you even have instructions for how to complete option A. If you compare that with the OpenAthens authentication page, you will see that it is rather clean and easy to use, really not complicated at all. Okay, this is from the dashboard from OpenAthens, and these are the resources that we currently have available with OpenAthens authentication. I really enjoy the statistics that you can get from the dashboard. So currently we have almost 14,000 users that are using OpenAthens, and if you take into account that it's only the first part of the year and we don't have all our resources available on OpenAthens, I really think that's a great number. This is the usage statistics that you can see. The one on top is you can actually drill down and see the daily usage, and to me it's quite interesting. We all knew that nobody's using our resources a lot over weekends, and then there it is quite visible that the peaks are during the week and then the lower points are during the weekend, and then the lowest point was during a long weekend when almost nobody used any resources. And then the bottom part of the statistics, you can also see, the monthly usage, starting from January, where the technical services staff mostly used OpenAthens testing it. And then in February, we introduced it to the rest of the library staff. And then from there, our clients used it with a peak in May and then tapering down in June, which we expected because then the students started to write exams and prepare for the examinations, and they currently having a winter break. So the usage is not that great, but we know that it will pick up again when we move to the second semester. We did have some unforeseen outcome. I think the thing that we didn't expect was the change management and the soft issues or the delicate issues. Especially with regards to library IT, because OpenAthens is such an easy system to manage that we have, we don't rely that often on library IT anymore. So that is a delicate subject. And then also with regards to our librarians, and that is mostly, I think, because of the second bullet point that I have here. One of the things that we had to do is we had to change the links in our catalog and library management system from WAM links to OpenAthens links. So that was quite a big job to do. But you also have to change it for the LibGuides and the library web pages. So it does involve quite a bit of work for our colleagues to do as well. And then I asked Khona in preparation for this presentation to share with me a few of the emails that we received from our students with regards to OpenAthens. And it seems like mostly they have issues. They're not sure which login and password to use. So that means that we still have a bit of work to do to make sure that our clients know that they just use the UJ login and password to authenticate. Okay, so the way forward is we really need to address the change management issues, the soft issues. Yesterday was a good day because we got approval from our executive director to move all our information resources to OpenAthens. And we want to do that by the end of the year so that we can start with OpenAthens fully from the beginning of next year. And we also still have a lot of marketing and awareness to do in this regard. And then we have to convert this whole OpenAthens project to a process so that it becomes part of people's daily routine and daily task and not handled by the project team any longer. We also want to add additional features. We really have the vanilla flavor at the moment. We want to add additional features like the faculties and departments and then staff and students so that we can have more in-depth user informations and information about who is using which resource at what time. And then we really want to link it at to the BI system as well, because we think that that will give us a holistic setup about the usage of our information resources. So yeah, what I was trying to tell you with this presentation is to say that it seems like a difficult thing to do. You know, when you move over from IP authentication to, you know, federated access. But for us, in our experience, really and truly, we used a way that was suitable for our environment. And that will really be my message to you, is if you do think of moving over, take your environment into account and do it in a way that will be best for you and your users. So thank you very much. That is the end of my presentation. I have my email address there, so you're most welcome to contact me. And if you have any questions, you're welcome to ask.
Awesome. Awesome. Thank you, Janina. So we now enter the Q&A session of the webinar. And I want to encourage everyone to enter questions in the questions box, as indicated by a big green question mark. So there are a couple of questions already that have come in. So the first is it possible to get the recording of the webinar? Yes, you will receive, as long as your email is available when you registered, the recording link will be sent to everyone that registered for the webinar. Then there's another question about how do your users access those resources not yet in OpenAthens when not on campus?
Okay, so for now we have a dual system running. We still have the WAM authentication running for those resources, and then we have OpenAthens as well. So what we did with the OpenAthens authentication is we have a database list on our webpage, and those resources that are available on OpenAthens, we indicated to the users, you know, that they can access it through OpenAthens.
Thank you for that. Then there's another question that says, were there any services that you could not incorporate into OpenAthens?
Not yet. Everything that we asked for, we could move over to OpenAthens. And it was actually quite interesting because even some of the South African databases that we really struggled with in the past, we could move those over to OpenAthens. Nothing at the moment that we couldn't move over. That was the good news.
Great. So you highlighted some of the benefits of federated access. Can you then also talk a little bit more about achieving consistent user experience from any location, right? And how has that been received by the library patrons?
I think it has been received very well. If you look, and this is my opinion, if you look at the way our users access information right now, and maybe it's because I have a second here, a daughter who's second here, they don't really, you know, follow our way of searching, going to the data bases, you know, and using the databases as a starting point. They really use Google. So we did two things in our library. We implemented OpenAthens, and then we implemented another product called Lean Library. So with the Lean Library pop-ups, whenever we have information that's available in our library, our electronic resources, the student get like a pop-up message to say, okay, we have this article available in the library, or this is a reputable open access resource. And then we combine that with OpenAthens. So if you land on some page when you did a web search and you can access via OpenAthens, you actually get a pop-up to say, you know, you can use OpenAthens, which is your usual login and password to access this information, which makes it really much, much easier for our students. I think it's very important to get the students, you know, where they are browsing from, you know, and not to make little librarians out of them. So, yeah, we've really had very positive feedback in this regard. And the students, you know, are amazing. They want to get information with as little trouble as possible. And I think they're easier, you know, to learn new things and to try new things than my generation possibly.
Yeah. So as a follow-up question to what you just said, what's been the impact? And even though you only have a few months of, you know, of usage to measure, right? But have you noticed any difference in terms of usage, you know, compared to maybe not this time last year, but this time 2019, right? You know, what can you talk a little bit about that for the products that are being accessed via OpenAthens? What's been the impact on usage of those subscriptions?
Funny enough, the usage of our ebooks increased substantially. Unfortunately, I cannot give you an explicit reason for that yet, but really and truly the usage of ebooks, that really increased significantly. It's difficult to say at this stage, you know, with regards to the databases, and that is because we have some issues regarding this year we have some issues with the way the database is displayed in our searches. So that impacts on the usage. So it's difficult to give you a direct answer for that. What I can tell you is the usage of OpenAthens, you know, almost 14,000 active users. I really think that is amazing. And unfortunately, when you use WAM, I know from our side, we can't compare. We don't know how many people are using WAM, so it's difficult to make that comparison. But I know we're very, very happy with the number of users we have in OpenAthens.
Awesome.
In such a short period of time.
Yeah. A couple of other questions have come in from the audience. One is your OpenAthens available to only the UJ community or any other communities outside the UJ community?
Okay, our OpenAthens is linked to our license agreement, so that is only to the UJ community. We, whether you use IP or OpenAthens, you need to adhere to the agreement that you have with your supplier. So yeah, at the moment, it's only to the UJ community. However, one of the things that we experienced in the past, and I'm sure other universities experience it as well, is many alumni members are asking for access, you know, to the electronic databases. And in the past, it was very difficult with WAM, you know, to those databases that do give free access to only give access to alumni members. But with OpenAthens, you actually have the option, you know, to add alumni members and to give them access to certain resources. So that's one of the things that we want to do next year, is to start implementing that as well.
Yeah. And I know that there's been, you know, around federated access, moving majority of access to federated access, there's also been the question around walk-in users, right? After we get past the other pandemic, and how would that work? You know, and I'm wondering if for you, you're also thinking about that, right? So given the, you mentioned that there's approval now to move all your products to, you know, federated access, move all your products to OpenAthens, therefore federated access. A couple of questions there. Does it then mean that you plan to move away from IP? And if that's the case, and in connection with this question about other communities, are you thinking about how you would also give walking user access to other communities that come into the library but not affiliated with the other university?
To start with your last question first, yes, definitely. I think if you look at what's happening right now with authentication, I don't think you have a choice. We have to move over to federated access. So yes, definitely move over to Open Athens fully. Then with regards to walk-in users, I think that's one of the nice features of Open Athens is you can create a user for a specific period of time, you know, so you can create a user for like a day visitor, and then after a day, you know, the user access expires. So that is very nice. We have that feature with WAM, but it's rather a complicated process to do, and you know, it's a difficult process currently to keep your finger on. You know, you have to follow quite a few steps, whereas with Open Athens, you know, it's much, much easier to do and to make sure that they don't have access for too long.
Yeah. A couple of other questions. First is for me, which is, what's the link between Open Athens and Elsevier? So at the beginning, I explained that over the last 18 months, Elsevier, we've been looking at federated access, right, as a potential future access management method. So we've been working on a project to look at the feasibility of that. And in connection with that, we've been working closely with Open Athens because we believe that their software makes it easier, right, for different libraries to be able to manage federated access. So we've also been working on, you know, how we leverage, you know, our network as well for Open Athens, and that's what has brought us to this webinar today. Okay, the questions are really coming in now. The increase in your usage, was it a result of Open Athens, or is it the COVID period?
It's difficult to give an evidence-based answer to that, but I think it's a combination of both. I think partly because our users don't have a choice. They have to use the online resources now. So that's part of it. But I think also because we made it easier for them to access the resources. So in my opinion, it's a combination of both.
Okay. And then how do you deal with students or users who fail to gain access via Open Athens?
As I say, currently we use WAM in our database list. Whenever somebody experiences access problems, they can complete a form to say what problems they experience. That comes through to technical services, and then we deal with these. But few and far between with regards to Open Athens, I must say.
Okay. The next question could be for James or for both of you. It seems a little bit more detailed. It says, how does Open Athens facilitate access to the electronic resources subscribed by UJ? Right. It seems a bit more of a technical question.
Sure. You know, yeah. I'll answer it for much, so I'll give you guys a break and I'll answer this one. Yeah, there's kind of two ways in which this could happen, and that's where we're coming in here with this federated method, and then there is an IP method. And so with Open Athens, you've got both products in there, which is how at UJ they're able to hopefully move all their resources onto OpenAthens is that we can facilitate federated access where required and, you know, as a priority method. And then there is a backup IP, but OpenAthens is doing it all in one go. So actually, if you'd like to know more about federated access and how that works, I could do it very briefly now, but how sort of federation works is you have the service providers, the content providers on one side, and then you have the universities, the institutions such as UJ on the other, and you both join into this sort of community, if you like, this network where you kind of have agreed or a shared understanding already. What this means is it kind of makes setup and the authentication process much simpler because, as I say, you've already agreed to how you're going to work and communicate with one another. So that's it very briefly, really. But we can obviously do our whole federated piece if you like. And I hope that answered the question in how that is facilitated. The actual process that you would go through as a librarian within OpenAthens, in the setup, EBSCO or OpenAthens, whoever sets you up, will obviously set up your account on your behalf as much as they can. But you can do it yourself as well. And the tools and features are in there to do it quite simply. It's really just a simple case of almost allocating a resource. In one of the slides earlier, you would have seen the sort of cards, if you like, of all the different service providers. And you simply just click allocate and you allocate that resource to your account once you've told that service provider that you are going to use OpenAthens to access them. So it's really that is as simple as the process to facilitate access this. Yeah, and I don't know if you want to add anything to that from your side, Janina.
I have absolutely nothing to add, except to say that it is as simple as that.
So given, and again, I think, you know, since you only have a short period of time, maybe 6 months or even a little bit less than that, in terms of the tickets, right, support tickets, what's been the impact within the last 6 months for your library, you know, for the products that are now being accessed via OpenAthens?
I think it is so much less. We really have fewer issues than last year. And I think if we do have one or two issues, it is, you know, mostly because we're still, you know, setting up some of the things as we go along or learning things as we go along. But with regards to access from a user side, really and truly, there are almost none, almost zero. And as I said, you know, the issues that we do get, you know, is the users are not sure yet which login and password to use. And that is something that we need to address from our side, but very stable access. And I don't know why, and I don't know if you maybe know the answer to this, James, but one of the issues we also used to have with our databases with IP authentication is the display, you know, of the web page. And somehow when we moved over to OpenAthens, the display of the web page improved for some of our suppliers. So your it is really on our experience just so much easier. And you know, and I think for the users as well, you know, the fact that we have stable access now makes a huge difference in their lives. Last year, literally, and I'm sure many people will agree with me, it was a nightmare. You know, when we suddenly moved over, I think one of our databases didn't work properly for something like 3 months, you know, where we tried to pinpoint the problem to find out where the problem was. And just like, you know, some of the articles mentioned, we still don't know. We managed to figure or resolve the issue, but we still don't know what the problem was and why we couldn't get it to work properly last year.
Yeah. And what you just said resonates even on our side, on our side at Elsevier. When we look at the support tickets that we get from users, the majority of them tend to be access related. But when we then isolate that to the customers that are coming to us via federated access, you know, for the most part, we then see that the tickets are drastically reduced, right? On our side. So that's also one of the things that we've been looking at in terms of, you know, what are the upsides, and of course also what are the downsides to federated access. But the upsides tend to be really stacking up quite well. There's a question from the audience that says, is OpenAthens a technology that can replace easy proxy?
James, I think you're.
It's probably safer for you to answer that, Janina, than James.
In 95% of cases, certainly. Obviously, everyone's easy proxies can be slightly different, but it's rare that you can't. And in fact, most of our customers are moving from a proxy, such as easy proxy or WAM, as in UJ's example here. They're moving from that to OpenAthens, and OpenAthens can certainly usually completely remove the need for that proxy solution moving forward.
Yeah. We see it on our side as well. One example I'll give is that during the early months of the pandemic last year, on Science Direct, we saw IP related access just really take a nosedive. Right. Mm-hmm. And this is, you know, as people moved off campus, and presumably they were then trying to get on campus via proxy. Right. But before you could do that, you have to go via the university's VPN first, then get on the proxy, then get to Science Direct. Right. And that was a headache. What we then saw was a very sharp increase in federated access traffic. Right. But things then, so the federated access traffic just continued to go. The IP related traffic kind of leveled off, but it never quite got back to the levels that it was at in 2019. So I think from that perspective, in terms of easing the convenience of people to access from, you know, wherever they are, right, then that becomes something to look at. There's also a lot of literature on this question, right? So whether it's on Scholarly Kitchen or on some of the other library journals, this big question around, you know, could federated access, no matter if it's being facilitated by OpenAthens or Shibboleth, could it replace proxy solutions? So I think there are also written material to look at to also help you answer that question. There's, in terms of security, so you touched on security a little bit, Janina, right, as one of the reasons why you, UJ, made the other decision. And we've also heard and read a lot about cyber attacks, right? During the pandemic, I mean, they've always been there, but they were heightened during the pandemic. Could you talk more about the improvements around security? Of course, I understand that there are some sensitivities, that things that you can't talk about, but with federated access, have you seen from your perspective that the security is definitely much more improved?
Absolutely. In the beginning of last year, before we even started, to work from home, our access to one of our databases were stopped twice. When we still used IP authentication, it was stopped twice due to suspected cyber attacks and so on. So then you have to get it going again. Since then, that same database was moved over to OpenAthens, and we haven't had any issues since then. So even though it's just one example, definitely you're more secure than IP authentication.
Great. And UJ is a major research university, right? And I'm sure as you were going through the consideration of federated access, there were some anxieties around that, right? Around moving, you know, doing such a breaking the mold, as you put it, right? So what has been some early lessons learned after you've broken the mold, or as you're still in the process of breaking the mold?
To be honest with you, I'm going to start from the beginning and then talk about the technical services stuff. I think our biggest fear was the setup, you know, and getting OpenAthens to work within our IT infrastructure. I think that for me personally was one of the biggest fears, you know, that something will go wrong and that we won't be able to set up and use OpenAthens. And I think that's why we took the cautious route. If I knew what I know now, I would have started with a larger database list and not only start with a few. If I knew it was going to be so easy to do, I definitely would have started with more databases and not the few that we've chosen for the beginning. So we're actually very excited to move the rest of our databases over. I thought that also that it would involve more work from UJ, and I also thought our fear was that you really need good technical knowledge and expertise in order to implement and maintain the system, and that was one of the pleasant surprises. I think one of the things, and I've mentioned it earlier, that that caught off guard, and that was, but we have clever catalogers and they resolved the issues, was to update the links in your catalog, because once you go over to OpenAthens, the WAM links that you have in your catalog for ebooks and things like that, they don't work anymore. But we have a clever cataloging team and they updated those links. So you're preparing people, you know, to change those links, I think was one of the lessons learned, definitely.
Great. So we have 3 minutes left and I have one final question. If there are any other questions from anyone else, here's your chance to post it.
Now's the time.
Yeah. So looking ahead, 10 years from now, right? What's the most prevalent method of access to library e-resources? Is it still IP-based access, or is it federated access, right? You know,
I can't see it being IP access, and I think it's because of that. When I used that slide about OpenAthens and SAML, you know, the fact that it gives personalization to our users, which they want, it gives the security to the supplier that they want, you know. So it's actually to the benefit of both. And if you can have an authentication system that works for both sides and then for the library, I think that is the way forward. Security is becoming more and more important. So I definitely, if there's something better than federated access, most probably because things change so much faster, but in my opinion, I can't see it being IP authentication.
Thank you so much, Janina. And also thank you, the audience, for joining. Everyone that joined again, you will automatically receive a link to the recording so that you can share it with others and listen to it again. I think you shared a lot of wisdom for us here in this webinar. So I really appreciate you agreeing to do this.
For
Elsevier as a publisher, you know, this, we're trying to really promote these ideas, right, around, you know, how to improve access to resources, in general, and just increase access to knowledge. So thank you all so much for participating. We'll leave it there.
Have a great afternoon, everybody. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.